Harper Audio presents Working Together, Why Great Partnerships Succeed, by Michael D. Eisner with Aaron Cohen. Read by Rick Adamson, with an introduction and epilogue read by Michael D. Eisner. Copyright 2010 by Michael D. Eisner. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers.
Work and love and friendship. Two of those three will result in a great partnership. All three will result in a great life. To all my great partners, my loving wife of 43 years, my three sons and their spouses, and my present and future grandchildren, I dedicate this book, and to Frank Wells. In May of 2008, I got a call from Bob Miller, founding president of Hyperion Books, the publishing unit of Disney that we began in 1991. "I'm leaving Disney and starting a new imprint at HarperCollins," he said, "and you have to write a book for me." Before I could decline, my natural first response, he plowed forward. "How about a book about you and Frank?" he said. "A book about partners, about how partnerships work." I did what I often do when I hear what I think is a great idea, even if nearly every fiber in me is saying that I'm too busy and too distracted to get involved. I answered quickly, "Okay, I'm in." Soon we hung up and it occurred to me that I had suddenly committed to a lot of effort, a lot of time, and a lot of procrastination, a Mark Twain kind of procrastination. I do not like work even when somebody else does it. Eventually, I called Bob back, and I asked for 2 years to get the book done. The idea intrigued me for a number of reasons. First, my 10 years with Frank Wells at Disney were the most successful of my career. Beyond the great vision we shared for the future, no one was more engaging than Frank. No one's drive to support ideas, business, and creative was more insatiable. Along with a great group of executives we assembled from inside Disney and our alma maters, Warner Brothers and Paramount, Frank and I worked hard together and succeeded together. But the comfort, the camaraderie, and the connection, family friendship, and intellectual fellowship all came to a crashing halt on Easter Sunday in 1994 when Frank died far too young in a helicopter crash during one of his many adventurous expeditions. After that tragedy, we carried on at Disney, producing more great animated movies, building new theme parks, and climbing new mountains, including one of the largest and most significant transactions of the time, the acquisition of Capital Cities ABC and ESPN in 1996. I remained at Disney until 2005, working with a handful of new partners, some successfully, some very successfully, some not so much, but none of the arrangements ever worked as seamlessly and effortlessly as the one I had with Frank Wells. And in the days, weeks, and months following my phone call with Bob Miller, I spent more and more time wondering exactly why our partnership worked so well. What had actually made that connection so extraordinarily productive and made us so much more successful than we would have been working alone? As I thought about it, I found myself wishing I was an artist rather than a weekend writer. Inspired perhaps by Marc Chagall, I would paint three canvases to make my point, all of a man riding a horse. The first would be a tiny man atop a giant horse. The second would be a giant man atop a tiny horse. And the third would be a man and a horse of equal size. In the first scenario, the horse would be too strong and too uncontrollable for the man. The second would be equally unsuccessful, for a tiny horse can't move with a giant man weighing him down. But the third match would be perfect, with the man and the horse able to move successfully in concert. The man represents intellect. The horse represents emotion. Both need to be equally balanced for any leader to succeed. The best combination, I've learned, comes from partnership, where two people balance each other, constantly reminding the other of the need to keep the conscious and unconscious in harmony to make each other smarter and each other better. Since I am not a painter, I came upon a different way to answer those questions in a book. Start with a look back at my time with Frank Wells, and then go to work and find some other partnerships that succeeded. I do some research, I make a list, I go talk to these partners, and hopefully learn more about how people work together. Turns out the list was easier to create than I first thought. The most successful and well-respected investor in the world, Warren Buffett, has a partner, Charlie Munger. The most successful figure to come out of the computer revolution, Bill Gates, famously worked with partners at Microsoft, and now in his new job, saving the world, quite literally, with his foundation, he has perhaps his best partner yet, his wife, Melinda. In Hollywood, you'd be hard-pressed to find a more successful or well-liked movie and television production company than Imagine Entertainment, run by partners Brian Grazer and Ron Howard, who've won multiple Academy Awards and produced and directed dozens of movies and television series. One of the biggest retail chains in the United States, Home Depot, was started by a pair of visionaries, Bernie Marcus and Arthur Blank. In fashion, the great designer Valentino spent half a century atop his world, flanked by an amazing partner, a man named Giancarlo Giammetti. In Los Angeles, among the most well-known and respected restaurant owners in town are a pair of chefs, Susan Feniger and Mary Sue Milliken, who've shown that despite the old saying, there is in fact room for two cooks in the kitchen. In finance, a company run by my childhood friend John Angelo and his partner Michael Gordon has been successful for decades, managing billions of dollars, not only surviving the financial meltdown, but growing during it. Partnership goes beyond the traditional definition of business as well. In sports, the most successful baseball manager of the last half century, Joe Torre, won his four World Series titles with a partner by his side, a man Yankee fans know well, his bench coach, Don Zimmer. And even the best ongoing party of the last 50 years, the Studio 54 Dance Club in New York, was run by partners Ian Schrager and the late Steve Rubell, who shared not only enormous success, but for a year, a jail cell. Writing the book required me to spend a lot of time with these people, interviewing them about their partnerships. I started the project while buying the baseball card company Topps, making a television show, working on movie projects, advising my three sons on 30 different projects when they let me, and being an entrepreneur. So Jane, my wife of 43 years, suggested I politely exit the project and stop driving myself crazy. It served as a first good lesson about partnerships. Always find a partner who's not afraid to tell you what they think. She was half right on this one. I started writing and stopped thinking about why I didn't have the time. Once I did that, I began to realize more and more that this project was not only interesting, but important and timely. If there's a single central story to be written about business in the 21st century, it is, sadly and regrettably, a story dominated by a handful of individuals who infected the economy with deceit, manipulation, and amorality, essentially the death of honesty. From destructive failures like Enron to the sociopathic deception of Bernie Madoff, to irresponsible banking and real estate executives and government figures, a lack of ethics has crippled the business world over the last decade. Partnerships, however, encourage a series of characteristics: trust, teamwork, a regard for someone else, and continuing checks and balances that run counter to the factors that contributed to the sequence of economic messes over the last 10 years. All in all, this is a perfect time to be encouraging partnerships devoid of envy, jealousy, and rivalry as a way to escape from the toxic culture that has given the business world a bad name and to instead help people chart a new, often overlooked path toward a better way of working. As you'll hear in this audio program, the people I met with were thrilled to talk about what they shared with their partners and what had made their pairing so successful. So much of the business world is supposed to be about getting ahead of the rest of the field and winning while someone else loses. And there are many, many stories in business of iconic individual achievers who stood tall atop their worlds. Yet the tales of these partnerships are not just about their spectacular success. They're about something else, something far more elusive. They're about learning to share and how great sharing can be, sharing success and sharing failure, adrenaline and frustration, laughter and tears. It is far from easy, though, and each of the partnerships profiled in this book illustrates a different way of sharing and different styles of working together. It is hardly as simple as dividing up power, authority, the spotlight, salary, stock options, and success down the middle. If it were that basic, this book would not be nearly as interesting. Instead, there are many different stories to tell, stories of pairs who are similar, and tales of duos who are different, partners who were the same age, and partners who were born decades apart, two men and two women, or one of each, loud and colorful characters, and modest and withdrawn figures. For all the contrast, there is one common thread. Collectively, the stories you're about to hear demonstrate the virtue of something that's often forgotten about, in business and in life. These are not just all successful people. They're also happy people. They enjoy getting up in the morning. They love what they do. And they are among the select and very fortunate few who have found that partnerships create happiness. These are the tales of 10 magical stories. These are 10 stories that show why working together is better.
Chapter 1. Frank Wells and I. Where I learned 1 plus 1 equals 3, if not much more. I still can't believe I said that, I told my wife. But like many things in life, you had to be there to understand the moment. It had been 8 hours earlier, a beautiful Saturday morning in September 1984 in Los Angeles. For the previous year and a half, Barry Diller and I had been riding a roller coaster at Paramount Pictures, working for Marty Davis. Davis was the head of Paramount's parent company, Gulf and Western. I had spent 8 years as the president of Paramount, brought there by Barry, whom I had been working for and with from the time we were 24-year-old assistants at ABC in New York. Barry had been a mentor, a teacher, and a friend, but was about to leave Paramount to go to 20th Century Fox, thanks to Davis, a man who Barry found unbearable and who'd become the chairman of Gulf and Western following the death of the eccentric but brilliant, supportive, and even affectionate Charlie Bluedorn. Without Barry, my life at Paramount, long so satisfying creatively and personally, was looking like it would be much less pleasant. Although I never really knew Marty Davis well, I did know he'd told Jeffrey Katzenberg, my talented young head of production, that Michael Eisner is like a kid playing with blocks on the floor. With delusional confidence in our performance, I had actually taken that as something of a compliment, but in some honest portion of my heart, I was pretty sure he didn't mean it so flatteringly. Furthermore, it appeared I would now be not only working with a tough boss, but going at it alone, without someone to bond with about this potential common enemy. In such situations, I had learned, shared frustrations could actually lead conversely to more creativity and more fun. But without Barry Diller as my partner, working for Davis was a very questionable proposition. Then, by fate or perhaps circumstance, just as I began to see firsthand the difference between Charlie Bluedorn and Marty Davis, I had been approached by another entertainment corporation, more than just a film company, more exciting and with bigger challenges to meet. That company, of course, was Disney, then called Walt Disney Productions, which had long been struggling to grow since the death of its founder, Walt Disney, 18 years earlier, and was now in search of new leadership. I had first been quietly approached to talk about working at Disney in late 1983, but the timing was not right for them or me. Now, though, it was a year later, and the company was being attacked by corporate raiders. And on this late summer day, I found myself at the home of an attorney named Stanley Gold, a round, rather larger-than-life man with bright red glasses, a ubiquitous, unlit cigar in his mouth, an odd sense of humor, and uncompromising loyalty to his one client, Roy E. Disney, Walt's nephew. I had been summoned to Stanley's Beverly Hills home to bring this courtship to a conclusion and determine whether or not I'd be joining the Disney company. Other relevant parties were in attendance, most notably a man named Frank Wells, who had run Warner Brothers a few years earlier before leaving Hollywood for a different kind of challenge, climbing the tallest peaks on each of the world's continents. He had scaled 6 out of 7 and was now back looking to resume his entertainment career. Frank and I had crossed paths over the years a few times, but I didn't know him very well. He was, though, close to Stanley, and as we sat out on the terrace, the two of them were presenting what I knew was the latest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.